What's up? Welcome back to my channel. Ooh, I had to take a sip of my coffee. Y'all already know, if y'all see my TikTok, that I always go to the morning jump. Not always, but majority of the time I go to the morning jump, and this is a golden night. So today's video will be about spouses, the application process, Wocs, finances, and possibly Wobc. And the reason why I'm saying possibly is because this may be a two-part video. I don't want it to be too long, and it is currently 8:43 and I have to be in the office at 9 o'clock. So I wanted to record this video and get it out for you all. I actually tried to record a video several times and I failed every single time. The quality of the video was so great, but I seen it and I went back when I was doing the edits and it looked like I had like a booger right here. I don't know what it was, but I was just like, ain't no way I'm posting that on YouTube for everybody to see. So I am on my fifth attempt at trying to create this video for you all. So if you are interested in this video based off of the title and the thumbnail, please make sure you watch this video to the end. I may answer some questions that you may have throughout this video. And so if you end up watching it and you're like, man, I still want to know this, I still want to know that, just leave them down below and I will get to you as soon as I can. I am extremely busy. I am a 920 alpha warrant officer, property book technician, and so my schedule is pretty busy. But in regards to today's video, it will be based about being a warrant officer, what to expect. Spouses basically have questions, and I don't want anyone as far as a soldier to get on here and feel like I'm like trying to snitch or give out information. But in all actuality, you all should be communicating with your significant others anyway in regards to this process. And if you don't know, you just don't know. But don't find out information and not tell the spouse, because the spouse needs to know and be informed about everything, especially if you have family. All right, so don't take this video the wrong way. I'm not getting on here trying to rat y'all out or basically tell everything in regards to becoming a warrant officer. I'm just basically trying to help, and I realize that I don't ever do videos in relations to spouses. And so huge shout out to Tammy. She is the reason behind this video. I really appreciate you sending me emails and me being able to answer your questions. So huge shout out to Tammy. Her husband is putting in a warrant packet, so good luck on this next upcoming board. I hope you get selected. And again, today's video will be about me answering questions and going through the whole Wocs process. I am currently in my vehicle for soldiers, that is a POV, because I just have some time to spare. And I was supposed to have did this video a while ago. Well, actually September the 4th, and today is September the 12th, and so I'm behind. Like I said, I have a few minutes to spare because I'm about to go to work. And so I just decided to record this video in my car or in my POV. So this video is going to be broken down into like three different parts. Again, I'm not going to try to make it long. And if I do not answer a question, please make sure you comment down below. If there is something that I answer and you don't understand, somebody who is watching this video and you are in the military and you know, please chime in and feel free to answer that question if I don't get to it before you do, because you may have already went through that scenario. Okay, so this video will be about me, who I am, my life, basically just a little bit about me. The second part of this video will be the application process, what to expect when getting selected, how many people can get selected. I mean, it is just so loud. And the third part of this video will be about Wocs, what to expect at Wocs. And then the fourth part of this video will be the finances while you are in Wocs. And so based off of how much time I have, those are the things that I will be covering. And then I will get on here probably one day this week or next week and do a part two and talk all about Wobc, PCS, and what the Army will and won't pay for. And I actually have my iPad because I have notes. And so if you see me stopping or pausing looking at my iPad, that's because I want to make sure I give y'all all the scoop and all the tea on what to expect when becoming a warrant officer. Okay, so a little bit about me. We'll go ahead and get started with a little bit about me. My name is Amelia Danielle Fullwood. I have been in the Army for 16 years. I am active duty. I have two children, 7 and 17, Phoenix and Jaden. They both play football. My son Jaden does AAU basketball. He does basketball for his school as well. I am stationed at Fort Liberty, aka Fort Bragg. I am 36 years old. I have been married almost 10 years. This October the 11th will make it our 10-year anniversary. I think, did I say my husband was prior Navy? He works on post at the finance office. So if you have any finance related questions, please feel free to ask and I will get you an answer as soon as possible. One more thing too, I have this scarf on my head. I always tie my hair up before I go to work. Basically, once I get dressed and I get ready to leave the house, I put my scarf on just to protect the flyaways and like the frizz. To maintain it. So if you are trying to figure out what this is, it is a headscarf. I posted a whole TikTok and YouTube short in regards to me wearing a headscarf. And so I will be having this headscarf on throughout this video because once I get ready to go inside the office, that's when I'll take it off. Or I will have this scarf on the entire time I am recording this video. And then right before I get out of my vehicle to go inside, I will take it off because this headscarf is not authorized to wear in uniform. I'm not sure if I said this already, but I am 36 years old. My birthday is May 5th, Cinco de Mayo, 1987. I have an associate's degree, a bachelor's degree. I have veneers, which I have a video on that. I get Botox in between my eyes and on the side of my eyes, which is called crow's feet. And I am currently going through laser hair removal. I am on my fourth session and I just recently went to go get seen for tattoo removal. So my hobbies are helping others, recording videos, making videos, taking a lot of pictures, vacationing, going on trips, and just being with my family and my kids. And so those are some of my hobbies. But the number one thing that I like to do the most is help other people. So that's pretty much what you'll know and find out about me. I felt like I just had to say that for the spouses. If this is your first time watching me, who I am, y'all can know who I am. I didn't want to jump right into the video and start talking about everything because this may be your first time watching me, especially because this video is geared towards spouses, okay? So we will go ahead and jump into the next part of this video, which I will be talking about the application process and becoming a warrant officer, okay? So first and foremost, if you want to become a warrant officer, go to the Army Warrant Officer recruiting page and then look at the requirements. There are different requirements for different MOSs. For example, my MOS that I wanted to go warrant for is a 920 Alpha. You go to the Warrant Officer feeder MOS list and then you will click on it and it will tell you all the requirements. For example, for me, I need to have English 1, English 2. I needed to be a sergeant who had completed ALC. Now they have a new requirement saying that you need to have completed at least 1 year of PBO time or PBO experience. You need to have at least a 110 GT score. I'm pretty sure for every MOS, if you are trying to put in a warrant packet, you have to have at least a 110 GT score. And those are just some of the few requirements that I need it for my MOS. Your MOS may be different, but if you go to that website, you will know exactly what you need. So in regards to needing a 110, if you don't have a 110, like I said, the 110 is not waiverable. It is not waiverable. It has never been waiverable. I have asked several times and it will never change. You just need a 110. So my recommendation is to go to BSEP. If you need the words, then I will send you the words via email. The word knowledge is double points, which means if you get all 16 words correct, 9 times out of 10, you will get over a 110. I made a video on BSEP, at least 2 or 3 videos. And so please go watch that. And it will help you out. I had recommendations on why you should come to Fort Liberty to take the BSEP class. And again, I have the word knowledge list. So in regards to the application process, see what the requirements are. Go to the recruiting page. You need to have a 110. Another thing too is if you want to become a warrant officer, you cannot be on a profile. It can't be a temporary profile and it can't be a permanent profile unless it is a shaven profile. Now, I'm just speaking based off of what I have encountered. Because again, this is my experience. This is my opinion. I have not seen or ran across any warrant officers who have put in warrant packets be on a temporary or permanent profile unless it was a shaven profile. So if you are thinking about going warrant and you are on a temporary profile, do what you need to do. Go to physical therapy, get off the profile, and then put in your packet because you need to go get a physical and the doctor will not clear you based off of your physical if you are on a temporary profile or you are on a permanent profile. So work on getting off of that temporary profile or that permanent profile and then move forward. But still make sure you take care of yourself, because you don't want to injure yourself, because being at Wocs, you might end up getting hurt. You just have to be careful and mindful. So whatever you feel like you need to do to come off of that temporary or that permanent profile is very well worth it. I think you should do it and do whatever it takes. But if this is not your career goal or your career path, then by all means, this video is not for you. Okay, what else in regards to the application process? You need to have a senior LOR, which means if you don't know who your senior warrant officer is, or if you don't know who to go to get a senior letter of recommendation, you need to talk to your higher headquarters, which means if you're at the company level, if you're at the battalion level or the brigade level, they should be able to direct you and let you know who your senior warrant officer is, okay? Reach out to that senior warrant officer, let them know that you are thinking and considering about putting in a warrant packet, and what do they need from you in order for them to be able to write them to want to write a senior LOR on your behalf. Okay, another thing you need to consider when you are putting in your warrant packet is going through the warrant officer recruiting team. I went through the warrant officer recruiting team. They walked me through the entire process. They, you know, told me what errors I had. They uploaded everything through Gears. They let me know when my packet was board ready. I communicated with them constantly. My warrant recruiter was Sergeant First Class Tran. He actually just went to Wocs. I am so super proud of him, because he have been helping all of these soldiers at Fort Liberty put in their warrant packets. And you can do the warrant packet on your own and upload it through that email on the site, but I don't recommend that, because you might not hear from that email for like 2 or 3 weeks, versus if you go through the warrant officer recruiting team, they will respond to you right away. If you're not stationed near a warrant officer recruiting team, you can always email them, you can always call them, and they will help. They are there for that, is their job. And so I would say to work with a warrant officer recruiting team, and the difference between them and the actual email address that you have to use to upload your warrant packet is, when you upload your warrant packet, you won't know about any errors or mistakes unless they email you back and say, hey, you need to fix this, you need to fix that. Versus when you go through the warrant officer recruiting team, you can take them your packet or you can email them your packet, and they'll tell you like, hey, this is wrong, this needs to get fixed, you need to do this, you need to do that, you don't meet these requirements. They'll just tell you basically without wasting your time or being antsy about it, because like I said, when you upload your packet to that email, it might be 2 or 3 weeks before you hear from them, and they might be kicking your packet back saying that is not board ready, or you need to fix these errors, versus the recruiting team will tell you right there on the spot. You can communicate with them daily or constantly, I would say. So I recommend going through them. Another thing is, when you are thinking about putting in your warrant packet and you want to have several people review your warrant packet, try to make sure you have at least 3 to 4 warrant officers review your packet. I understand a lot of soldiers are having the first sergeants and the sergeant majors look at their warrant packets, but those first sergeants and sergeant majors are not warrant officers. The only thing they really look at and check are your NCOERs, and that's just not what the packet only consists of. So I understand why y'all do it, but if you can find 3 to 4 warrant officers to review your packet, then by all means, go ahead. I'm not knocking the first sergeant and sergeant major, but I'm just saying, if they knew what to expect and look for on a warrant packet, they would have became and put in a warrant packet, and they didn't. So look, if that's what y'all want to do, cool, but my recommendation is to have 3 to 4 warrant officers look at your packet. All right, so in regards to, let me look at my iPad for a pass so I can start looking at some of the questions that I need to answer. So one of the questions was, can you tell me, out of all of the packets that the board receive, how many people are actually selected? So if you go to the warrant officer recruiting page, it'll tell you the MIPR message based off of, you know, the most recent or current list of people that were selected. And if you go through that, you will see, so for example, 920 Alpha, 920 Bravo, they select maybe 10 to 15 people per MOS, and that's based off of every MOS. So if you are going for a 915, a 923, a 920, a 920 Bravo, aviation tech, you will only see like 15 to 20 people names on that list, which means every board, which is not every month, that's how many people are getting selected. So I would say between 15 and 20 people are getting selected when the board convenes and the board results and the list comes out. So based off of the question, can you tell me, out of all the packets the boards receive, how many are actually selected? I would say 15 to 20, depending on your MOS. The next question is, are there a lot that are not selected? Yes, there are a lot of soldiers who don't get selected. And I will say that because based off of the new promotion system for Sergeant First Class, there are a lot of staff sergeant promotables putting in warrant packets because their OML number is high. So if you are getting looked at before the board and your OML number is in the 400s, 500s, you may possibly not get selected this year based off of your OML number being high. It just depends on how many people are getting selected every month for Sergeant First Class. And so with that being said, a lot of staff sergeant promotables are putting in warrant packets. So this last board, it was about 100 to 150 personnel or soldiers that put in packets to become a warrant officer for a 920 alpha, which is a property book technician. So out of 150 people that put in a warrant packet to become a 920 alpha warrant officer, only 15 people were selected. So to answer your question, are there a lot of people that are not selected? The answer is yes, there are a lot that are not selected. It's just the numbers are high because now no one wants to, you know, wait on the promotion system based off of the OML and making Sergeant First Class. So yes, it said the next question is, how long after you get selected did you get your Wocs and Wobc date? So I will say after I got selected, I got my Wocs date within like a month, and then I got my Wobc date like a month after that. I made two videos, which I will list down below, in regards to getting my orders, which is called your RFO, and all of that, and my Wobc date. And I'll check my emails again and list it down below in regards to when I got my Wocs and Wobc date. But it was fairly quick. It was a quick process because at the time that I put in my packet, it was COVID, and I don't know if like Branch or whoever was giving me my Wocs and Wobc, but they just had time to put me on orders to go to school and to go to Wocs, to go to Wobc. So I think it just depends on your MOS. I think it depends on your branch manager, how soon you will receive your Wocs and Wobc date. Again, don't quote me on that. I made two videos in regards to my Wocs and Wobc and my RFO orders. And so to answer your question, I don't want to say how long because every branch is different, meaning every MOS is different in regards to when you get your Wocs and Wobc date. I know for a fact that I got mine within a month of each other, and I actually got my orders on where I would be PCSing to before I even went to Wocs. And so it just depends, to answer your question. So it's not a definite answer. It just depends on your MOS and your branch manager. So I hope I helped answer that question. And again, I will leave those videos down below if you want to watch those videos. All right, the next question was, even though a soldier lists where he wants to go on his application, do they actually get those duty locations, and when will the soldier find out? And so this is like a 2 or 3 part question, and so I'm going to break it down. It says, even though a soldier lists where he wants to go on the application, do they get those duty locations? So I would say yes and no. So for me, because again, I'm talking based off of experience, that I listed the 3 duty locations, which my first choice was Fort Huachuca, Arizona. My second choice was Hunter Army Airfield. And my third choice was Fort Bragg, AKA Fort Liberty. And so out of all 3 of those duty locations, I was in contact with my branch manager. My branch manager actually emailed me and said, hey, I was looking at your choices, and unfortunately, we don't have Fort Huachuca available. That is a senior warrant position, so we cannot have you sit in a senior warrant position, especially since you just graduated Wocs or will be graduating Wocs. What about you're just not a senior? So a senior, as far as like being a warrant officer, is like a CW3 promotable, CW4. And so I wasn't able to go to Fort Huachuca. The Hunter Army Airfield base, they just didn't have any open warrant officer slots. And my third choice, which was Fort Bragg, I was able to stay. My branch manager contacted me and was like, hey, are you willing to go airborne? I said, of course. The reason why I wanted to stay at Bragg is because my son is in high school. And so I asked like, hey, do I need to do a high school stabilization? She said no. So I was very grateful and thankful for that. And I also did not have to go airborne just to stay here. There were a lot of open positions for a PBO 920 alpha here at Fort Bragg, and so I was able to stay at the same installation, which means I did not have to PCS. I went to Wocs, I processed, I went to Wobc, and then I cleared, and then I came to my new unit here at Fort Bragg. So I was able to get one of those top 3. Now your situation may not be like that. So for example, depending on your branch manager, you may be in Wocs or you may be in Wobc, and you might end up getting an email saying that you are on orders to go here or you are on orders to go there. If those are not one of the duty stations, if that duty location is not one of the duty locations that you asked to go to, hit up your branch manager and ask him like, hey, is there a reason for why you put me on assignment? department here? Or, hey, do you have anything else available other than this? Or, hey, can I be close to my family? Or, hey, can I, like, you have to communicate that with your branch manager. But there will be times where they will consider the duty location, and there will be times when they don't, only because we are needs of the Army. Once we, you know, go to Wocs and we complete Wocs, we are on 6-year contracts. We have to commit an additional 6 years, which means at the end of the day, we are needs of the Army. We have always been needs of the Army, and so that's just what it is. And so if you come down on assignment and it's not one of those three choices, then hit up.
You not?
So I left off on explaining and talking to y'all about different duty stations and to hit up your branch manager in regards to where you want to go based off of the three choices that you put on your application process. So the video got cut off. I had to go inside the office. I didn't get to finish it. And so this is what I'm saying in regards to not being able to finish the video, and it is like my fifth attempt. So today is actually Wednesday, September the 13th. It is currently 08:26. I am getting more coffee. Wanna get my Golden Night small. I'm not gonna get any breakfast, but I'm going to continue recording this video and talking to you all about the questions once I make it on post and I get situated and settled, because I have time. So I apologize for the inconvenience in regards to uploading this video. I know it seems like it's all over the place. I am deeply, deeply sorry. I just want to get this video out, and I don't know what's going on. I don't know why it is taking me so many times to get this video out. And also yesterday when I was recording, the sun started coming in. You can see the sun like beaming in the background. It was just a lot. It was just a lot. So I'm going to continue talking to y'all once I get on post and I get settled. Again, I have my scarf on. It is a whole completely different day based off of how I was filming yesterday. So yes, we are going to continue with this video once I make it on post. Y'all, I just made it on post and I just got two phone calls. I'm trying my best. I'm trying because I'm here for y'all. I'm here for the spouses. I want to get this video out, but my life as being a PBO is hectic. I have a whole lot that I have to do. But again, I went to the coffee jump or the morning jump, and I got me a Golden Night coffee, and I also got me a bagel because I'm starving, y'all. I got a bagel, blueberry bagel with strawberry cream cheese and an egg on it. So based off of where we left off, because I am in the parking lot and it is currently 8:46, and so I got about 10 or 15 minutes to finish recording this video. I'm gonna jump back into the conversation in regards to duty locations. And so like I was saying previously or earlier, like, hey, if you come down on assignment, just hit up your branch. If you have or if your family is on what is it called when your family, the EFMP program, so if you are on the EFMP program, that may play a part and a role in regards to coming down on assignment. You may not even come down on an assignment until you square away your EFMP.
Oh my god.
Requirements. And what I mean by that is, depending on like if something has expired, if you need to update something, branch may not contact you until you get that done. But for the most part, you do get to put those duty locations on the application, but based off of needs of the Army or whatever space or whatever slot is available for that MOS, for like 915 Alpha, 920 Alpha, 920 Bravo, 923, whatever your MOS is. You might be a 25 series. You will have to contact your branch manager. Again, sometimes they just contact you, sometimes they don't, sometimes you will come down on orders, and then sometimes you don't. It just depends. I would say it's situational as well. So just be mindful of that. If it's a duty location that you don't like or you don't agree, you may have to just roll with it, because at the end of the day, this is something that we wanted to do. That's just what we may have to do. All right, so moving on to the next question. I'm looking back down at my iPad. Okay, now we will start talking about Wocs. I feel like I covered everything in regards about who I am, a little bit about me, and I also covered the information in regards to the application process. And so if you have a spouse or a soldier that wants to put in a warrant packet, you will basically have to go through the requirements. You might have to have a waiver, you may not. You will wait until the board convenes, and then you will wait on the results to come out. If you are not selected at that first board, your packet will then get reboarded for the very next board, and then you'll have an opportunity to get looked at again for that board. If you are not on that board list, then you will have to wait at least a year before you can resubmit another warrant packet. Based off of my experience, I felt like the application process was easy. I had to do a waiver for time and service, so I had to have an AFS active federal service waiver for my time in service, because at that point I had just hit 13 years and that was the first step for me. So I did my waiver. My waiver got approved within like a day or two, and then I continued with my application, which I had already for the most part had everything filled out. It literally only takes you three to five days. If you are sitting down really focusing on completing your application, it shouldn't take you no longer than 2 weeks at the most. I feel like if you need to take leave to complete the application process, take a day or two of leave, go get your physical, wait on them to call you to come pick your physical back up, put your physical packet with your application. You need to have the S2, which is a security clearance memo. You need to put that with that. But for the most part, my application process was easy. I did my waiver, I did the application, did my had my senior do my LOR. The battalion commander has to do an LOR. Of course, like I said, you need to have a senior do your LOR. All of my NCOERs, I had to have G Army certificate and training done. I had already had PBO experience, and that is a new requirement now for 920 Alphas. If you are trying to put in a warrant packet, you need to have at least 1 year minimum of PBO time, but that is waiverable. And so that is another thing when you are looking at the requirements, you need to see what is waiverable and what is not. For example, like I said, the GT score is non-waiverable. So in that case, you would just need to go to BSEP and improve your GT score. But for the spouses, soldiers that are going warrant, there is like a process. It's not like the same when they go to MEPS and basic training, but when we go to Wocs, going to Wocs is like basic training. And so I'll go ahead and dive into talking about Wocs. And then after I talk about Wocs and the finances, this will conclude this video. And it's just taken a lot for me to get this video, a week or two to get this video out the way. And so I'm going to pause after I finish talking about Wocs and the finances, and then go into Wobc in on a different or a later video. So in regards to Wocs, what happens to the soldier BAS? And so when the soldier goes to Wocs for those 5 weeks, the soldier will continue to receive BAS. BAS is not for the family members. BAS is for the soldiers. And so, for example, if your soldier goes to the field for a week and he is eating hot chow in the field for breakfast and dinner, and he is receiving an MRE for lunch, when they come back from the field, S1 is supposed to take the BAH. That is an inspectable item for the DFAT warrant officers. I think they're called food service tests, but they do all the paperwork and they turn it in, and then S1 will then take your BAS from you. So when you go to Wocs, S1 is supposed to be tracking your BAS coming out. Now, whether or not they submit your paperwork for your BAS to come out, that's a whole different subject. That's a whole different scenario. When I came back from Wocs, I still had my BAS, which was $300 and something. But what I will say is, you will receive your BAS for the time that you are at Wocs, right? But what I will say is, save that money, that $360 something, just in case you end up having that money come out on the back end, and then you will see a deduction on your MyPay when you, well, not on your MyPay, but on the MyPay website. When you go to your LES, it will say meal deductions for 300 or whatever amount that you are receiving BAS, because while we are in Wocs, we go to the DFAT for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. Okay, so I hope I answered that question. Second question for spouses and soldiers is, can we visit our soldier while they are at Wocs? Spouses, no, you cannot. You cannot visit your spouse while they are at Wocs. I would just say, think of it as if they are at basic training. They are doing things every day. They don't even have the time to barely go to sleep, let alone come see you or for y'all to come visit. You can't even sneak to go look at them. You can't even, like, you just won't be able to do it. So in regards to that question, no, you cannot go see your soldier member while they are at Wocs. The only time you are permitted to go see them is during family day, which is a day before the graduation. And so the day before the graduation and the day of the graduation, you will be able to see the soldier. What is graduation like, and do we need to come a day early? Graduation lasts about an hour. It's in an auditorium. Just think of it as if that soldier completed BLC or that soldier completed AOC and you was there. So what happens is, we all are in like this auditorium, and we are all seated. We will stand when our names are called. We will stand and raise our right hand to the commandant, and we'll have to repeat after him. And then we go get our certificates and we salute, and then we walk off. And then that's pretty much it for the ceremony. So the ceremony lasts about an hour. Families are welcome. Kids are welcome. Parents, grandparents are welcome. If you would like to come a day early, you can come a day early. You can reserve a room outside of the gate. It's just a personal preference. I would say contact the hotel when you know the graduation date for the soldier. And if they are full, just try to get a hotel room off post. If you are deciding to drive down or fly down and you want to come the morning of, just be mindful that sometimes flights are delayed. Sometimes traffic is heavy. And so I would say just plan in advance. Try to get there early morning, because the graduations are usually around 10 o'clock and as possible. I wouldn't say come a day before. My spouse and my family, they came a day before. They actually got there that night, and so I didn't see them for family day because they got there too late. I did not see them until the day of my graduation. It says the next question that spouses have is, can our spouse travel with us after graduation to Wobc or back to our duty station? So if you are on assignment to go to Wobc right after you graduate Wocs, then it just depends on how long your Wobc is. And so if your Wobc is a PCS move, for example, if you are a 25 series, then yes, you will be able to go with your spouse to Wobc. Now, sometimes the way that they have Wobc set up, you will not even go to Wobc until like a month or two after you graduate Wocs. And so what I mean by that is you will graduate Wocs, and then you will go back to your duty assignment, and then, for example, your Wobc date may not be until a month after you complete Wocs. And so in that case, your spouse does not need to follow you to Wobc, because y'all need to go back to your permanent duty station. You need to go back and you need to chill. Whatever you do every day with your time that's on your unit and your supervisor, they might tell you that you still have to come to PT formation, and then after that you can go home and take care of whatever or spend time with your family, and then you'll just go to Wobc a month after that. Now, if you are on assignment to go to Wobc right after you graduate Wocs, what I would say is just check with S1 and check with transportation to see if you are allowed to follow your soldier and to see if they will transport your household goods. And what I mean by that is, and I say this a lot, if your Wobc is like 9 months, the Army is not going to move your household goods to the Wobc duty location and then move your household goods again to your permanent duty location. So you'll go to Wocs for 5 weeks, and then you'll go back to your duty station and have like a week, maybe 2 weeks, a month, 2 months, 3 months before you have to go to Wobc. And then you will go to Wobc, and your Wobc might be 6 months, 9 months. You will go to Wobc after you graduate Wobc. You will go back to your duty location, and then you will clear, and then you will PCS. Now, depending on how much of a gap or space is in between your Wocs, your Wobc, and your duty location, because after you graduate Wobc, you may be placed on assignment to go to Korea, or you might be in Wobc, you might be placed on assignment to go to Korea, but while you are in Wobc, you decide that you want to switch your duty locations. You decide you want to change and flip-flop with another warrant officer that's in your class. Like, hey, I don't want to go here. Let's hit up branch and see if we can switch. Hey, you contact your branch manager and say, hey, like, I'm in Wobc, I don't want to go here, or can you look out for me and I go there? So it just depends. I would say be open-minded, and just be patient and give your soldier time to figure things out and to communicate with you about what is going on. Sometimes they just don't know. Sometimes they may not receive an email. Sometimes they may not receive a phone call. Sometimes if they come down on assignment to Korea, because Korea is one of those hot and heavy duty locations for not just warrant officers, but for soldiers in general, then be understanding, because maybe at that point they can't do nothing about it. Maybe at that point they can't say, hey, I don't want to go to Korea. You don't have a choice. You don't have a choice. It is what it is. Just be understanding, be patient. And when they do go to Wobc, you know, I'm not going to talk about anything in regards to Wobc. I'm going to stay on track with Wocs. But the question was, can your spouse travel with you to Wobc after you graduate Wocs? And I would just say it just depends. I already covered if they take soldiers BAS while they're in Wocs, and based off of that answer, it's the S1's job to take the BAS. So you may have it taken, or it may be taken, or it may not be taken. Okay, another question is, can families go home to the home of record during Wocs and Wobc? And so, no, you cannot go to your home of record during Wocs, because Wocs is only 5 weeks. It's only 5 weeks. The Army is not going to move you. In that type of situation, if you are able to go to your home of record, that is because you have your Wocs date, and immediately after graduating your Wocs date, you go to Wobc, and then after you go to Wobc, you go to Korea, or you go to an assignment where you know, the family isn't coming. You just have to ask the transportation office, and then you also have to communicate. Sometimes when you go to Wocs, you might not graduate at the day that you're supposed to graduate because you may fail something. I know I failed something, and so my graduation date got pushed back a whole week. And so in regards to communicating, you will be able to talk to your soldier member via email and phone. So if your soldier fails something, just ask him, like, hey, how are you doing? Are you on track to graduate? Like, what's going on? Am I making plans to come down on this date? Or, you know, just keep me in the loop. Okay, the next question is, how will the finances be managed during Wocs? And so that's up to y'all. For me and my spouse, I know what bills I had to pay. He knew what bills he had to pay. We had access to each other's bank accounts. I have my own separate bank account. We share a savings account. So I have my USAA account. He has his USAA account. And then our joint accounts is through Navy Federal. If I needed a bill paid, I just got on my phone and paid my bill. If my husband was responsible for a bill, he just got on his phone or he got online when he got home and paid the bill. So the finances should already be something that y'all are talking about and y'all should both be in agreement with. But 5 weeks is not going to stop you from paying a bill. At that point, like I said, you can use the computers and you can use your phone. But if you feel like you are more in charge of taking care of the bills while your soldier is in Wocs, then by all means, y'all can do that too. I would just say that y'all need to communicate that. And last but not least, in regards to Wocs, the spouses want to know, can we talk to our soldiers during Wocs? Now, initially, when they go in process, like the first few days, you will be able to talk to your soldier whenever. Just whenever they feel like picking up the phone and calling you. Because when you're in process and you're just basically sitting in the classroom, going over paperwork, going over like certain things. And so at that point, when they first get to Wocs and they are in processing for a few days or a week, you can talk to them every day. Whenever. Once you cross over to Wocs, you will be restricted. You will be able to use your phone and communicate with them, but it might not be at your leisure, which means you have to be patient. And like I said, just be understanding. But phones are authorized and you will be able to talk to them. You just may not know when you will be able to. I'm pretty sure the soldier is going to let you know, like, hey, I have this going on today. I won't be able to talk to you until tomorrow. Or hey, if you don't hear from me, just send me an email. Or hey, you know what I'm saying? So what I would say in regards to that scenario for spouses, don't be upset. It is what it is. Like, me and my husband been married for so long. Like I said, it'll be 10 years this year. And so when I went to Wocs, I just hit him up when I could. And when I couldn't, it didn't bother him. He was just like, oh, okay, like, yeah, everything's cool. Or, you know, and sometimes I was just too tired to even have a conversation. I would just be like, hey, babe, like, I was just calling to tell you I love you. Check on the kids. I'll talk to you later. I'm tired. I'm going to bed. And then he understood that. So now that we are done talking about Wocs, we were going to the finances. And so what I did was I brought a coin, because one of the questions was, what do the coins look like and how much do they cost? And so the coins range between $5 and $10. I got 5 coins. I got one for myself, one for my husband, one for my best friend, one for my mentor, and one for my senior that wrote my LOR, and they were $50. And so depending on what you get on your coin and what size it is, it just varies. And so I would say you might end up spending between $5 and $10 on $5 to $10 on a coin, and it just depends on how big the coin is. And so just keep in mind that depending on how many you want, that's how much it will cost. And so if it was $10 and I ended up spending $50 on my coins because I got 5. So I named 5 people. So this is the front of the coin. This is what it looks like. This is the back of the coin. And as y'all can see, the sun is coming in, is doing the most, but I'm gonna continue. So in regards to the class number, or do it have the class dates on them? So it doesn't have the class dates, but it does have the class number. So my class was 22502, and it says, what do they look like? I just showed y'all what the front and the back of the coin look like. How much are class shirts? And so some class shirts range between $10 to $25. It just depends on what type of shirt you decide to get and how many. For me, I got 2 cotton shirts. You have the option to get a dry fit shirt. Of course, dry fit shirts cost more because of the material. So in regards to the shirts, I would say the prices range from $10 to $25 based off of cotton or dry fit. You can also get hoodies, crew nets. It's just a personal preference. If you want to get one of your spouse's or your soldier member's class shirt, just let them know, and then they will be expected to pay for that shirt as well. So if the soldier wants to get 3 shirts and they're all cotton, then that means it would cost $30. And so, yes. how much extra money is needed and for what items. And so I would say at least $100, maybe $200 to $200. And why I say $100 to $200 is because when you do your dress blues and or either your pink and green uniform, sometimes you don't end up getting everything that you need for your uniform. And then when you take your uniform to alterations or when they come on post to pick them up, there are different things that you need to get taken off and different things that you need to get added. For example, the shoulder boards, the rank, or whatever. So and paying for dry cleaning, you might need to get your shirt dry clean, you might need to have it altered, the pants might be too long, it just depends. And so in regards to alterations and dry cleaning, I would say it ranges for to like at least $100. I know I spent $100 on my dry cleaning and alterations even after I purchased everything. And as far as additional items, when you go to the PS to get personal hygiene items, you might want to purchase deodorant, toothpaste, soap, whatever it is, and that will range between, I would say, $10 to $50 depending on how low you are. When I went, I took like travel size items because I just did not want to have a whole lot of things that I had to carry with me. And when I know I was getting low, which it wasn't often, it was like 5 weeks, I think I ended up getting low like going on my third week. And so you really won't have to have too much money in regards to personal hygiene items. And so in regards to the finances and how much you will spend while you are at Wocs, I would say between $100 to $250. That was pretty much it in regards to the finances and how much you'll have to spend while you are at Wocs. Now this concludes today's video. I am actually late for work. I'm supposed to be in at 9 o'clock. It is 9:08. I'm sorry if this video feels rushed. I'm sorry that I talk fast. I tried to slow things down and I try to answer certain questions the best way that I could. Again, I wear a scarf. The sun is coming in. The whatever has been going on with me in regards to trying to get this video for y'all has not been on my side. But at the end of the day, I am here for you all. If you have any questions, please comment down below. I will link all of the videos that I mentioned in today's video down in the description box below as well. And if you are not following my social medias, go to my Instagram, which is my personal Instagram, at AmeliaG5587. My TikTok is AmeliaDanielle3. You can email me also at AmeliaG5587@gmail.com, and you can email me at my work email at Amelia.D.Fullwood.Mill@army.mil. So I hope this helped you all and the spouses. Until next time, this is Amelia. Peace.